Good morning and welcome to Christchurch online service for Palm Sunday. My name is Christine Mogford, if you don't know me, and I am the ordinand here at Christchurch. And later on, Nick, our vicar, will be talking to us. As I said, today is Palm Sunday, so if you have a palm cross, run and get it, maybe pause. this one I actually just made from stuff from the garden. But we're remembering the day that Jesus came into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. Let's start our service with a prayer based on Psalm 24. Lord of all the earth and everything in it, creator of the land and sea, cleanse our hands and purify our hearts, that we may stand in your presence and worship you. Keep us from idolatry, save us from making false promises, that we may seek your face and receive your blessing. For you are the Lord Almighty, the King of glory. We open the door of our hearts as you come among us. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Ride on, ride on in majesty, hark, all the tribes Hosanna cry. Thy humble beast pursues his road, with palms and scattered garments thrown. Ride on in majesty, in lowly pomp, ride on to die. O Christ, thy triumphs now begin, a captive death and conquered sin. Ride on in majesty, thy last and fiercer strife is won. The Father on his suffer throne awaits him. Ride on in majesty, in lowly pomp, ride on to die. Bow thy meek head to mortal pain, then take, O God, thy path and
thank you, John, for that song. Now, earlier in the week, Nick caught up with Aoife, one of our gap year students who's based in Hong Kong at the moment, to catch up with her.
Well, it's great to be joined by Aoife. You may remember that we interviewed Aoife back in December, and I thought it'd be a great opportunity to catch up with her. Just to say, there is a little bit of a time lag, so don't adjust your sets. It's sort of fine, but just bear with us. So Aoife, perhaps you could just tell us a little bit about where you are and what you're doing.
Yeah, so I'm in Hong Kong at the moment. I've been here for about 4.5 months and I'm here until June with my gap year. And I'm helping at Syngman Springs, which is the rehabilitation center founded by Jackie Pullinger. So I live in a house here with the teenage girls, mainly helping with them. And then I also do outreach in the city several times a week. That's what I'm doing.
Fantastic. I think when we spoke last time, you were actually just about to move into the house with the girls, maybe just after Christmas. How did that go, and what's it like? How many sort of girls are you sort of chaperoning, looking after?
The move went really smoothly, actually. Yeah, thank you so much for all the prayers. It was like a really natural kind of move in, because we already like spent some time with the girls. So it was nice to kind of finally properly join the family and like be living with them the whole time. When I moved in, there were 15 girls living there, which was pretty chaotic at times. And now 5 of them have moved on to like a second stage house. So they live in the city with like a couple, but they're kind of like reintegrating and like outside of the kind of bubble that we have here. So now there's 9 girls. I think we have a new girl joining actually on Sunday, which will be fun. So yeah, 9 at the moment. And I really love it. It's so much fun. It's pretty crazy a lot of the time, as you can imagine. A lot of teenagers all together. And of course, they all come from quite kind of challenging backgrounds. So there's a lot of personal stuff going on with them, which can result in a bit of drama. Occasionally, but I really love the girls, and it's been really fun living with them.
Do you sort of think they look up to you as a bit of an older sister? Does it work like that, or are you more an adult in their eyes?
I probably not an adult. I would hope like a kind older sister is what I go for, but I don't know on their end if that's what they think too. I mean, some of them are like 1 year younger than me. The oldest is 18 and the youngest is 13. So there's not much of like an age gap with some of them. So yeah, I'd say like sister is probably kind of vibe.
Yeah, fantastic. And you were telling me earlier that since we last spoke, you've been baptised. So tell us a little bit about how that came about and what happened.
Yeah, so I've been kind of wanting to get baptized since it's been maybe like 2 years since I gave my life to Jesus. And maybe, yeah, past year I've been kind of thinking, oh, maybe I want to kind of like declare my faith with baptism. But because of COVID, I was like, I didn't really see it happening. So I kind of forgot about it. And then I think I was reading Romans 6. I think it is about like your past life, like dying with like Jesus and then like resurrecting with him and like coming new life. And after reading that, I just felt really like inspired to get baptized. And the other gap year, Eva, who lives with us as well, wanted to get baptized as well. So it was just really exciting doing that with her. And I just felt like it's been such an encouraging time and exciting time for my faith. It just felt like the right time to just to officially commit with the kind of with the baptism. And it was amazing. We went to a beach and got baptized in the sea, which was very nice. Very glad I managed to do it abroad rather than in a little pool in the church. Even there, you know, that's nice as well. But
yeah,
it was, yeah, great scenery as well.
I don't think we can compete with that. That's so encouraging to hear. And wow, just a really very public statement of faith to recognise your journey. So far, brilliant. If I'm just sort of wondering, you know, how have you been encouraged personally during your time in Hong Kong? I mean, you're obviously loving it out there, and no doubt there's some challenges, but what have been, you know, some of the encouragements for you?
I think I've been especially encouraged by like seeing the transformation in people, like once they know Jesus. Like from when the new girls come in, going from the kind of like, well, a range of things, but like often like timid or angry or just a lot of kind of like dark emotions, and then just seeing the way that as they like grow in their relationship with Jesus, as they like read his word and we worship together, just like seeing him kind of like lift them up and like set them free from what they're experienced before, It's just been amazing. I just feel like I've been kind of like blown away by like the like seeing the power of Jesus. I feel like it's so like tangible here. So that's really encouraging. Like when I come back, just like has motivated me more to witness what you can do in people's lives, and I really want to bring that to other people.
Fantastic. What do you think that you've learned about yourself then, and about God during your time out there? Because it's obviously such an amazing time of growth for you spiritually. But yeah, what have you learned about yourself and about God?
Yeah, living with in like a big house of people definitely, yeah, brings a lot of kind of self-reflection on how you like interact with different people and like what pushes your buttons and I think it's really great opportunity to like focus on like serving other people, especially in the house, and like putting their needs before yours. Because kind of every small thing you do, you have to think like, oh, if I do my laundry now, is there enough room outside? Like, does someone else want to do their laundry? If I like cook this, is this going to be messy with other people? So yeah, I think I've kind of realized that putting others' needs before your own is really hard sometimes, especially like if you're really tired or if like, sometimes it's just hard, but it's been good practice. And I know it's so very generic, like blessed I have been with like my upbringing, where I've grown up, and yeah, it's just given me kind of new perspectives and made me recognize where I should be like being more thankful a lot of the time, and just like recognizing how many like blessings I've had, and kind of using like the fact that I've been able to like have such good education, such good upbringing, like being able to then use that to like get a job where I can then like help other people.
Thank you. And I mean, that's a challenge for all of us, I think, to sort of reflect on how blessed we are in our situations and all the blessings, yeah, the advantages that we have. You're over half way now through your time in Hong Kong. What can we be sort of praying for you as a church as you sort of enter this sort of second half of your time out in Hong Kong?
I think firstly, it's starting to get really hot and humid, and it kind of just makes everything like that a bit more difficult when you're like really hot and it makes you feel really like drained. So on a practical level, just prayer that I can learn how to deal with the humidity and not let it wear down my patience and affect the way that I treat everyone that I live with. I think prayer for patience as well. I feel like, yeah, my patience gets tested a fair amount in a lot of situations here, which is really good practice. But just that I can be like really strong in my patience and not let things like small things bother me. And also, I think last time I kind of explained that I like half help in the house and I half do outreach. And since moving with the girls, I've like grown to love being with them so much that sometimes I'm slightly like, oh, do I have to go and do outreach? Like, I kind of just want to be with the girls all the time. Because I just feel like I sometimes make like a bigger impact here, because it's more like personal, and because I've got to know them over like 4 months, I can just be more helpful. But the outreach is like such an amazing opportunity, and they're so exciting. So I'd love prayer for like fresh enthusiasm for outreach, and that there can be that God can provide opportunities where I feel like I'm really making an impact, because I know like I can, and we do with the outreach team. Mm-hmm. But just that I can be like motivated.
Brilliant. Well, let me briefly pray for you now, and then you're going to bring us our Bible reading today. So thank you very much for doing that. But let me first pray for you. Heavenly Father, just thank you so much for the way that you are continuing to guide Aoife out in Hong Kong. Father, we thank you for calling her to serve there. Lord, we want to pray for those things that she's asked for, Lord, for renewed energy amidst the heat and the humidity, for patience, Lord, with those around her she's working alongside and caring for. And Lord, for that renewed vision and energy across all the things that she does with the outreach, as well as alongside the girls, Lord. We just thank you for the many blessings. We thank you for the encouragements that Aoife has received and the way that she's continuing to grow in her faith. Lord, we just pray that you would continue to watch over her, keep her safe, Lord, and encourage her, Lord, as she seeks to be your witness in that place at this time. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Aoife. You're going to bring us our reading now from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 11.
Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter Zion, 'See, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on the donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee."
Thank you, Aoife.
We have come to the time in our service when we confess that we are not perfect, that we are fallen. Let us ask God to reveal to us what he would like us to confess. Please join in on the words on the screen. Lord God, you have taught us that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We humbly confess our sins to you. Now keep your promise, forgive our sins, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord, who is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and full of love, who will not accuse us forever or be angry with us always, who does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our wrongdoing, have compassion on us as a father has compassion on his children, and forgive us our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'm not a fan of boxing as a sport, but the spectacle of the ring walk is now a major part of fights. The ring walk is simply how a fighter gets from his changing room to the ring. Once upon a time, even for a boxer's biggest fights, ring walks were a straightforward matter.
There was no entourage, no pushing and shoving to get in front of the TV camera. The trainer led the way. The fighter put his hands on the trainer's shoulders and they walked to the ring with his support team behind him. Things are a little different though now. In 2005, the boxer Floyd Mayweather was carried to the ring on a throne borne by four musclemen clad as Roman centurions for his fight against Arturo Gatti. In 2007, Yogi Arca rode a horse to the ringside for one particular fight. These days, ring walks are choreographed as elaborately as a West End show. Vladimir Klitschko's ring entrances were staged like a Wagnerian opera, with smoke, flashing lights, dramatic music, multiple video screens, and whatever pyrotechnics the venue allowed. Anthony Joshua, the current world heavyweight champion, enters the ring as part of a sound and light production that rivals Cirque du Soleil. It was the American boxing trainer and commentator Teddy Atlas who said, "The ring walk in boxing is essentially two fighters taking a short but long journey to a place that's dangerous and dark." We can perhaps see a similarity between a boxer's ring walk to that dangerous and dark place and Jesus's journey to the hill on Golgotha, where he was crucified. And yet, before that comes the triumphal entry. The late Muhammad Ali arguably the greatest boxer of all time, once said, "I don't care how much money you have, I don't care who your friends are, there's nothing like the sound of the crowd when you come down that aisle and they're yelling, Ali, Ali. You'd give your life to hear it." Well, little did Ali appreciate that when Jesus entered Jerusalem to the sound of the crowd cheering him on, that he would literally give his life a few days later. So let's turn to our passage this morning at the beginning of Matthew chapter 21, where we find Jesus entering Jerusalem on the colt of a donkey, to the fevered shouts and praise of the crowd who went ahead of him and those who followed him. First of all, we need to understand why a donkey. After all, it's not quite as impressive as a horse or being carried in on a throne. Well, in doing so, Jesus was fulfilling a prophecy. We see that in verses 4-5, a prophecy made by Zechariah, who lived around 500 years before the birth of Christ. He was what we call a minor prophet. He has a book all to himself in the Old Testament. It's a difficult book to understand on some levels, and yet there's no other book of prophecy which has more to say about the Messiah or points more clearly to Jesus. In the future, Zechariah saw a wounded king, a shepherd, one for whom all creation was waiting. In other words, he saw Jesus. The use of a donkey was a deliberate act. It was a public expression of his messiahship. As Jesus rode into Jerusalem, the crowds cheered and sang patriotic slogans. And verse 10 says that the whole city was stirred. I wonder how Jesus felt at that moment, being greeted like a conquering hero, surrounded by adoring people, madly waving palm branches, shouting, "Hosanna!" It would be tempting to get carried away by it all, but not Jesus. He knew he was on a journey towards a dangerous and dark place. Can you imagine for a moment the sadness that Jesus felt as he looked into the faces of people around him that first Holy Week? Can you imagine his sadness with the crowds who were shouting, "Hosanna," one moment, but would cry, "Crucify," next? Sadness with his disciples, one of whom who would betray him, his most trusted who would deny him, and the three closest to him who would not even stay awake with him in his moment of need. Jesus knew that the crowds would soon turn on him. The disciples would desert him. He would be falsely accused, flogged, and crucified. That his father would turn his back on him. That he would not leave Jerusalem. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem takes us to the very heart of Holy Week as we journey with Jesus to the cross. In the midst of this current lockdown, we can almost miss the importance of this coming week. One commentator wrote how one of his congregation once said to him, "I don't really do suffering," as if it was an optional extra. Well, it certainly wasn't for Jesus. It was necessary. It was intricate to his story. Can I encourage you, as we come into Holy Week, to lingle a while in Holy Week this year, to walk with Jesus through the days leading up to Good Friday. Perhaps join us for one of our evening reflections online. Can I encourage you to recognize that Jesus entered Jerusalem because he had the richest of prizes in his sight, our salvation. We are intricately involved in the events of Holy Week, precisely because Jesus went through it all for us. Arrested, beaten, flogged, spat at, abused, deserted, dragged up the hill, crucified for each one of us. I wonder who remembers the old Peanuts cartoons with Charlie Brown and Snoopy. In one of the strips, Charlie Brown and his friend Linus are standing next to each other, staring at a star-filled sky. Charlie Brown asks Linus, "Would you like to see a falling star?" To which Linus replies, "Sure, then again, I don't know. I'd hate to have it fall just on my account." Well, the point is that a star did fall on our account. Jesus entered into Jerusalem precisely because of us. Jesus was committed to going to the cross to save us from the penalty of sin, to mend broken lives, to identify with our suffering and pain, to bring us back into a loving and healing relationship with God, and to offer us hope and a future. The civil rights activist Dr. Martin Luther King said this, "Even if they try to kill you, you develop the inner conviction that there are some things so precious, some things so eternally true, that they are worth dying for." Jesus entered Jerusalem because he had found something so precious, something worth dying for. Us. I may have told this story before, forgive me if I'm repeating myself, but a number of years ago, a magazine carried the story of a memorial service held for a former Vice President of the United States, Hubert Humphrey. Hundreds of people came from all over the world to say goodbye to their old friend and colleague. But one person who came was shunned and ignored by virtually everyone there. Nobody would look at him, much less speak to him. That person was the former president, Richard Nixon. Not long before, he had gone through the shame and the infamy of Watergate. He was back in Washington for the first time since his resignation. Then an amazing thing happened. The then president, Jimmy Carter, entered the room. And before he was seated, he saw Nixon on the other side of the room, all by himself. And so Carter immediately went over to him, and as though he was greeting a family member, stuck out his hand to the former president, and to the surprise of everyone there, the two of them embraced each other. And Carter said, "Welcome home, Mr. President. Welcome home." We were born to know God intimately. And when we accept Jesus as Savior and invite him to come and be Lord of our lives, Jesus says to us, "Welcome home, my child. Welcome home." Jesus began a short but long journey to the darkness of the cross that first Palm Sunday, not to be a martyr or to lead a revolution, but so that one day we would hear God say to us, "Welcome home." We don't know when that day will come, whether it's just around the corner or years away. But when it comes, as surely as it will to each one of us one day, when we hear those words, "Welcome home," we will know it is all because of Jesus, because of what he went through for us, so that we can take our place in glory and see him face to face. Amen.
Christ the Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. In power resurrected, as we will be when he comes. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when he comes.
Psalm 130 says, I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. Let us pray. Father God, this week we marked the year anniversary of the coronavirus lockdown. And Father, we take time now to pray for those who have experienced loss. Loss, Father, in so many forms. For those who have lost loved ones. For those who have lost jobs or opportunities. For the loss of contact and the loss of the joys of friends and family and time with them. We pray for those whose relationships have been stretched, for some stretched and broken, for others stretched and strengthened. And Lord, we pray for those who are tired, who are physically, mentally, or spiritually tired. We pray for those who have been working on the front line with the NHS over this past year. Father God, we pray that we would know the comfort of a loving God, whatever the losses that we ourselves have experienced. And Lord, we pray that we would know the comfort and care from our community. Lord, particularly for those who have been bereaved. Lord, however hard the practicalities, that we'd be able to make known that we stand with them in their grief, just as Jesus, you stand with us. Lord, help us to be aware of the needs of those so near to us and yet who can feel so far away. Lord, challenge our selfish lifestyles. Help us to see need as you see it and to respond. And Lord, in a quiet moment, we bring our own feelings from the past year to you in prayer. And we particularly lift up to you those that we know that have been bereaved or that are ill or suffering. Father God, in your rich mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, thank you that where there is loss, there is also hope. And you are a God who brings us hope and points us to the hope of the cross. And Father, as we come into Easter week, we thank you that there is hope in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Lord, we pray that we'd be able to celebrate this hope as a church and as individuals. And Lord, that we'd be able to share this hope with those for whom it currently isn't something that they know or understand. Lord, help us find opportunities to be witnesses to the power of Easter. And Father, help us to celebrate and share with those around us. Lord, and alongside the hope of Easter, we thank you too for the hope of spring and for the hope that the success of the vaccination project brings to our nation. Lord, we pray for those involved that you'd continue to guide and sustain them. And Lord, for those countries that are struggling to achieve the same levels of success that we're currently seeing, we pray that there would be wisdom and support. And Father God, looking away from our own needs of our community and country, Lord, we look at the complex, precious world that you've created for us to live in. Lord, help our nation and world leaders to govern justly and fairly. And Lord, help us as nations share our resources. Be those resources of skills, vaccines, finances, or knowledge. Help us to share those with countries less wealthy. And Lord, we pray for those countries around the world that have found that COVID has exacerbated their already existing poverty, inequity, war and instability. And Lord, we name to you countries that we're aware of from the news or our own contacts. Father God, help us as we prepare to slowly reopen from this current lockdown. Lord, thank you for the joy of anticipating meeting those that we've not seen for such a long time. Thank you for our children being able to return to schools. And Lord, pray that you continue to strengthen them and their teachers with the challenges that that can bring. Lord, thank you for opportunities for sport and recreation and the impact that those have on our wider health. And again, we just pray that we would enjoy these changes as they come. Lord, we wait for you, and in you we put our trust. Let us finish by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins just as we forgive those that sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Next week is Holy Week and there is so much going on. We will have reflections most days and a Passover supper and an hour at the cross. If you need the information for these things, they should be on our website. We are now going to watch a video about the Bishops of Guildford's Community Fund, which supports vulnerable and marginalised through the diocese.
Dorothy, Jovi and Claude, it's really nice to meet you. And Dorothy, tell us a bit about the work of the Sunnybank Trust.
We're based in northeast Surrey and we support adults with learning disabilities, providing social activities, advocacy, which is giving them a voice when it's needed, and a transition service helping young adults develop independence and community resilience. So a lot of work for about 300 adults at the moment.
Jovi, tell us about a couple of the clubs that you're involved with.
Yeah, well, on a Monday, we've started doing this cinema club, which people come along to and we watch, like, musical sing-along films and everyone brings their popcorn. On a Thursday, we do a drama group, which is very chaotic and makes people smile.
Claude, it's lovely to meet you as well. Tell me about what you most enjoy about the Sunnybank Trust.
Long time no see.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah, because normality, yeah? Yeah.
You want normality.
Why in the bank is good, because it's not like give us music, everything, first up shop.
So Claude goes to the swag club, yeah, and loves the music.
Martin gave us music, by the way.
And Martin's the DJ and does the music. Brilliant.
Dorothy, the Sunnybank Trust received £5,000 from the Bishop of Guildford's Community Fund a while back. How's that helped?
That's been a tremendous help. It came at actually a really important time, just before the pandemic. And it meant that we were able to provide a lot of online activities straight away so that people weren't frightened, they weren't on their own. And it meant that we could also do a lot of advocacy around the hospitalisations that were going on. So it's been really, really valued and very important. Thank you.
Thank you to you as well for the fantastic work you're doing. Really inspiring to hear about it.
Owen is now going to lead us in our final song.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done.
For joining us for this service, and please join us for Zoom coffee after the service at 11. Let us finish our service with a prayer. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace as we trust in him, so that we may overflow with hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.